first thing we want to think about in preventing swarming is relieving congestion. And we do that by adding the appropriate amount of space for the number of bees that are in the colony and that are soon going to be in the colony with emerging brood. Here, for example, we have a hive that's got about 6 frames of bees. If we add it too soon, then we set this colony back because they're heating extra space. This colony had 8 frames of bees in it and about 6 frames of brood. It was ready for super, so we've added that on there. That super not only provides space for honey, but more importantly, this time of year, and we're in late May right now, more importantly, it gives space for the expanding population of bees to move up into and relieve congestion. Swarming occurs just prior to the main nectar flow, so that's the time period we're at right now. And if you think of it from an evolutionary perspective, that makes sense that bees would swarm at that time of year. That way both the parent colony and the swarm have the opportunity to build up their populations, store away food for the winter, and survive the following year. So once they get into the major nectar flow, they totally abandon this swarming behavior, and all we can just then focus on honey production. But we got to get them through the spring, prevent that swarming if we're going to produce that honey. So a second method of swarm prevention is dividing colonies. And what we're doing by dividing colonies is basically simulating a swarm. We divide the hive ourselves. We get to keep both halves in this case, but we prevent the colony from swarming by relieving that congestion. We can do this splitting even after we've supered colonies. You don't need to wait to super your colonies until you have a queen in hand and can split your colony. I would super colonies and then split them when you have queens available to do so. That way you'll prevent the swarming but also get your split later on. The splitting happens right before the main nectar flow, so it works in our favor too, because both our split and our parent colony can build up and store away a honey crop. A third method of preventing swarming is by requeening colonies. So in other words, keeping colonies with relatively young queens in them, because young colonies with young queens are less prone to be swarming. So just regular requeening, making sure colonies that go into their third year with a queen get requeened, will help to prevent swarming. A fourth method of preventing swarming behavior is to use stock that has a low tendency to swarm. We work with buckfast bees that are specifically bred for a low tendency to swarm. It's not easy behavior to breed towards, but some strains of bees are much more prone to swarming. And one management method we can use that helps to breed for swarming, it's pretty easy to breed for it, is by dividing hives that are preparing to swarm and using those swarm cells in making the divides. That way we're actually actively breeding for swarming behavior, and pretty soon all our hives are swarming all the time. A fifth method is clipping one of the queen's wings. We clip about a third of the wing off, and what we do this for is to mark the age of the queen. We also use paint markers to mark the age of the queen, different colors for different years. But with the wing clipping, we clip a left wing on an odd year and a right wing on the even year. It acts as a bit of a backup for the paint marker in case that paint comes off. But it does in a minor way help to prevent swarming. Only that it will prevent that queen from leaving in a swarm. What can happen though is that colony can go ahead and swarm with one of the virgins that issues during the swarming process. So it's a minor component of our swarm prevention method. If we stop bees from swarming, then they will produce a surplus of honey that we can harvest, and we can ensure that they have a good healthy population of bees going into winter. Thanks for watching. See you next time.